when I say World War II, oh, by the way, you guys, I haven't posted the recordings from Friday because I'm just getting rid of disk space or freeing up disk space on my computer. So wait until this afternoon to watch the videos from Friday. So going back to today's topic, we're going to learn about World War II. So when is World War II? When did World War II take place? Roughly what decade? If you don't know, maybe at least tell me what century.
30s?
Yeah, right. So the late 1930s, and it finished up roughly around 1945. Of course, the war didn't start with as a world war. It started more as a regional conflict with Germany trying to get more territory or consolidate its territory, which was taken away from it during World War One, during which it was the aggressor as well. So Germany really is the instigator, the provocateur of both world wars. And as you know from last class, Hitler was the leader of World War II. So let me go ahead and start off looking at sharing some pictures, and then we'll watch a video about Jesse Owens. There's a guy named Mike Uxlong trying to enter the class. I don't know that name, and I don't think I should enter in someone whose name I don't recognize. Let me just ask this person what's going on. Hi, Mike Uxlong. I guess they're not, and now they're not on the list here. Oh well, who knows who that was. So here they are. Mike, hello, Mike Uxlong. I don't know who this person is. Hey, Mike. Nope, there they go. Did you guys, I don't know if you saw Mike there, everybody, but that was like some random person. That was the first time I've seen that. All right, so let's go ahead now. Anyone have any weird things happen in their other Zoom classes with other professors? Nothing? All right. So I think, I don't know if we saw this picture last week. Did you guys see this picture in the last class, AJ Rizzo?
No, we did not.
Well, let me ask you then, what do you think's going on here? It's not a pleasant way to start your Monday morning, and yet it's a very important, probably perhaps the most important sort of subject in World War II. What are we looking at here?
I'm assuming those are Jews pulling a cart of dead bodies.
Right, and we all probably know the Holocaust was one of the probably saddest parts of human history, if not, of course, World War II, or of World War II, if not human history, and especially because it's modern era, so close to the present day. And in addition to the observation that this cart is being killed, being pulled by Jews, basically denigrating them or relegating them to the equivalent of mules, of donkeys, of animal labor. What else besides this, AJ Rizzo, might you observe? Who's in the body or who's in the cart? Who specifically do you think? They are Jews, yes, but it might be gypsies, might be gays, but let's say they're Jews for now. What's the relationship between the people pulling the cart and the people in the cart, AJ?
The people in the cart are like women and children who wouldn't be like essential to like labor, where like people pulling the cart are like men.
Yeah, so that's one layer. That's a labor. Great. So I want to point out all the really important observations here AJ's making. First, Jewish people are pulling a cart full of Jewish people. So that's already kind of should raise alarm bells in your conscience about sort of people having to pull sort of dead bodies. That's already sad. And then on top of that, you could think about, well, what happens in these labor camps is the weakest survive. Typically, what do we say when people are leaving the Titanic looking for lifeboats? What do they usually say about who goes first? AJ?
I'm sorry, say that again.
When the boat is sinking and people are scrambling for lifeboats, who goes first?
Wouldn't it be women and kids?
Women and children. That's a classic refrain in movies and in emergency situations. And that's a little anachronistic, or so I guess a little sort of dated, that terminology. And yet it's very interesting to apply it to this, because what is this, women and children first, AJ?
No, it's definitely last. Well, they're definitely first to go. Not.
No, joking aside. Yeah, it's a flipping of what you might expect to be the normal order of society, of civilization, which is you take care of perhaps the most vulnerable first. But here, of course, the most vulnerable, the first to die. Now, on top of that, AJ, who you mentioned who is pulling the cart, they're Jews, but think about an even more specific relationship between the people in the cart and the people pulling it. How might they be related as apart from religion?
Could be family members.
Right. So that's, I think, an even more, for me, that's the most horrifying aspect of this painting, which was done, by the way, I think in the 90s as a way to remember the Holocaust, reflecting back on what had happened, because in the 1990s, a lot of Jewish people who survived World War II were dying and wanted to remember it so that you never would forget what happened during World War II. So this is a painting reflecting back on that time. And yes, the horrifying observation made by Cody here, I think it was Cody, is that these kids or these women and children are being pulled by their own husbands, right? So it's an even more horrifying spectacle, that of seeing husbands pulling not their only their own wives, but their own children to presumably bury them. All of this, of course, forced by the Nazis who wanted to exterminate the Jews because of this notion of Aryan supremacy. And if you remember from last week, we were talking about how Hitler and a lot of countries, honestly, including the United States, for a while in the 20th century, really went way overboard in their faith in technology and science as a sort of moral basis for society. And as we know, you can't really use science to moralize. Science is great at providing proof, at telling you the facts of the world, but not really evaluating it according to any morality. And so I would offer that this picture really shows how Hitler used industrialization, the scientific application of sort of, or the application of science, which is sort of engineering and industrialization, but put it towards something really that's not the same as agriculture, not trains, but killing people. So to industrialize the killing of people is one thing if you're a soldier and you're dying from bombs, but it's another thing if you're killing civilians and you're industrializing the death of people. Because really underlying all that is the assumption that people aren't worth their lives. They're not human. So you dehumanize people as part of the industrialization of death. And so when I talk about industrialization here, Cody, what here in this picture is a symbol of industrialization?
The train in the
train,
background.
Right, the train in the background. I think we've got Cody's mom here. That's great. So is that Cody? Is that Cody?
Yeah,
that's great. No, that's awesome. Please, I'm glad we got more people to join us. So yes, the train in the background. And that train, what's inside the train?
What's inside the train?
It could be other Jews in there that are going to different camps.
Right. And so in a way, the painting is showing this sort of cycle, like a loop, an almost sort of a horrifying sort of process of the train arrives and the cart goes this way and then the process continues. And you can see it's the industrialization of death with the train, like the specter that sort of stretches out away into the horizon, bringing people with a sort of very forlorn kind of smoke stack that releases a sort of like almost like anticipating the ashes of the burned bodies. There's another element here that is a symbol of industrialization. You might think in the back, the telephone lines or maybe the electrical lines. But what's so interesting? Why are they pushing the Jews in a cart and not using a train? Callie, why do you think they're using a cart and not a train here? Is that an industrialized way of doing it? The cart?
No, it's kind of an old fashioned way of doing it.
And why do you think the artist chose to, and not that this is accurate, but what's the, perhaps the symbolism, or how might that relate to the train as far as why are the Jews being pulled in the cart and not, why wouldn't they bring them in a train to the graveyard or something?
It's forced labor.
Yeah, so it's labor, and they are using human labor, right? They're not using the machine. They're sort of the machine is there to scoop up all the bodies, right? But the cart is there because basically they're not gonna waste any money on this sort of dirty work of the last stages because they want them for the labor, right? They don't want them for the burial. So they're sort of like just throwaways at this point. And so really, I think there's so many layers of dehumanization going on here, including, Yeah, just I think we've covered sort of the basics going on.
Look at the faces of the.
What about the faces? Tell me about the faces.
Look at the faces of the Jews that are pulling the cart.
And maybe the one pushing it, right? There's two in the front pulling. There's two maybe in the back pushing. And their faces look like what?
Like death.
Right. Like they're already halfway to being skeletons, right?
I'm sorry. I like this stuff.
No, it's great. I think everyone enjoys having a family member pop in on class. What, any other observations?
They're already halfway to being skeletons.
Right, they're already halfway to death, right? And what about, if I ask you, or Justin, what about the color? What role does color play here? Are you there, Justin Murphy?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
That's great. Jocelyn, are you there?
Yeah.
What if I said, what role does color play here? What role does color play in this picture?
They used a lot of like neutral and darker colors to give it a more
neutral.
Like they're not bright. There's not really a lot of contrast in colors. Nothing's really jumping out at you, and it gives it more like.
What role does color play here? So if I said, what role does the iceberg play in Titanic? Well, you say that. Well, the iceberg's there to sink the ship, right? I said, what role do the colors play in the American flag? You'd say, well, they symbolize different aspects of the values of the country, yada, yada, yada. If I said, what role does the color of outfit that a woman, like a red dress play that a woman wears? Well, it's very eye-catching. So what role do the colors play in this picture, Jocelyn? You're right. You're absolutely right about what colors we see, but that's an observation, not an evaluation. So you've observed it, right? But evaluate what role they play.
Well, all the people carrying the wagon are wearing white. So that lets you know that they're like all together. And then the guy with the stick in the corner is wearing a different color.
What I'm trying to get at is the artist enlisted colors for a specific purpose in this painting. He didn't pick bright, happy colors. He didn't pick...
The colors are symbolize death.
Right, exactly. Or you don't even need to say symbolize so much as it sets a tone, right? Like it sets a sort of murky, maybe anxious, but definitely dark, as moody, death-like tone. You follow that, Jocelyn?
Even the SS leader is in dark as well. But
right.
He seems a little more pronounced, like he maybe has control crisper. And he's the leader.
Yeah, and color here really sets the tone here. And what's that tone, Jocelyn?
It's very sad.
Right, and that's the key. That's the only, you don't have to go very far, not rocket science, just the tone of the color here sets a very sad, you know, if you did bright colors, it would be inappropriate, ill-fitting to what we're looking at, right? So, if anything, what's the most colorful part of the painting, Jocelyn?
Probably the.
That's different than saying, what if I said, what's the brightest part? You might say, well, the sky, right? And that's kind of bright.
No.
So it's partly bright, so the train is contrast, so the train stands out, right? But the maybe the most colorful part might be the people in the cart. No. We see blue and red and green.
Yes. Can I say that the red scarf is a very simple, like a piece, like in this as well, like the the dead woman's wearing.
Yeah, and it's almost like it makes it even almost more sad because it's almost like their colors have now like been forcibly faded, right? And on top of it, we've got this baby. So it's a really horrifying picture. And the arm dangling is a really powerful part because you can almost feel it sort of swaying, you know, this lifeless arm as they're pushing it. So it's a horrifying picture, and it's important to see this horror because that's really the real outcome of World War II is when the West and the Soviets reach Berlin and reach Poland and reach different parts of the territory Germany invaded and realize that they basically exterminated all their prisoners of war for various reasons, but most important of all is their lack of conscience, right? A conscience is that which tells you what is right and wrong. And anyone who kind of lived through World War II and experienced this, you know, it's like it's the memory of this is an indelible part of human history, not just German or American history, because it really should be a warning to the future that you never want to industrialize death and you don't want to dehumanize people in the name of fascism or in the name of anything. Like, you don't dehumanize people, because as soon as you dehumanize people, you're allowed to kill them, and that's really a bad thing. So let's move on from this and look at some of the sort of other aspects or perhaps the foreshadowing of this by the era preceding World War II, namely the Olympic Games in the 1930s. And this is the very first Olympic Games since Greece, since ancient Greece in the ancient era, 2,000 years prior to 1938. I believe this is 1938. And this is the first Olympic Games since the ancient world. So this is Hitler, I think, really showing how he's trying to emulate the Roman Empire, the Greco sort of Roman history that we know from the beginning of the semester. And this is before the Holocaust. This is before everyone got the big wake-up call about the horrors of fascism. And we learned a lot about sort of the propaganda, so we don't need to go into that. But it's important for you guys to understand how sports plays a role and continues to in the world today. And it plays a role as sort of a symbolic warfare, but also as sort of Hitler's using sports to showcase the superiority of the presumed superiority of the quote unquote Aryan race or the German sort of people in its purest form, whatever that means. So here we can see Hitler watching the games. I believe that's probably what the Japanese prime minister, and he's watching very intently. He's got his Nazi party there. And here we see one of our very first images from sports photography. Who are we looking at here? Who shall I ask? We got any sports? Oh, Mark, who are we looking at here, Mark?
Isn't that Jesse Owens?
Or anyone can tell us. Who is it?
Jesse Owens?
Yeah, Jesse Owens. And who is Jesse Owens?
A black sprinter.
Right, and why is that significant? His race or what he's doing, either one?
Race.
Why is his race significant? Anyone? Mark?
He was the first black track runner in the Olympics for the United States.
Yeah, I don't know if he necessarily was the first per se, and that could very well be right, but the key part is that he beat the heck out of all of Hitler's other sports contestants, and in the symbolic act of beating Hitler's designated rivals or champions was very important, because as we just talked about, the Aryan race is about as opposite as you could get from, or Jesse Owens would be the very opposite of what Hitler thought of as superiority. So it's very much a struggle, a symbolic sporting event, as well as a literal sporting event of who wins, right? And so this is before World War II. And now I would like to show you guys a video that I think does a better job of sharing the importance of this and some twists and turns in the story that some of you might not know about. The typical story you'll hear is that Jesse Owens, like I just said, beat the Germans and almost symbolically beat the Germans before World War II had even started, because he let them know that, look, your idea of Aryan superiority is wrong. Just look who won. So it's a little more complicated than that. I think you'll see that in this video now that I'm going to share. I'm sure you guys can hear this. You guys see this and hear it all right? You guys hear that sound okay? I just stopped it, of course.
The opening was a big moment for the games. Hitler himself came to the opening ceremony. He swept out from the Reichschancellery in this enormous motorcade. The whole street was lined on both sides with people. There were swastika banners and Olympic flags all along. There was much shouting and screaming and throwing of flowers and Sieg Heiling. It was delirium.
Everyone hearing everything okay? Mark, you hear it all okay? Everyone hears the sound?
Yes.
Cody's mom, you hear the sound okay?
Yes. Yeah, I can hear the sound.
And Cody,
you can hear it.
In Berlin's massive new stadium, thousands of visitors from around the world witnessed a spectacular opening ceremony.
It's described by Thomas Wolfe, the American novelist, who was there, as an almost religious event. The crowd screaming, swaying in unison, begging for Hitler. There was something scary about it, this cult of personality.
Now, remember, even in appearance, Hitler's blending military and he's a sort of a military civilian leader. So we're already sort of, instead of the separation of military and civilian leadership, which even though the U.S. president is the commander in chief of the army, the U.S. president doesn't necessarily come from the army or the military. Hitler is very much sort of both literally and symbolically a military leader. And we don't really see that very often today unless you're talking about certain countries. Even the Chinese president dresses as a president because he thinks it's more important to be like a civilian looking leader because that's less perhaps aggressive. But in this era, people didn't know the difference or didn't know better. And we've really learned better than people knew at this time how dictatorship really corrupts countries absolutely if you give a dictator absolute power. Let's continue.
Hitler wanted to be on top, in his box, overlooking everything, like as if this was his celebration, this was his event. He wanted to be glorified, that was part of it.
We're all standing on the infield, the grass, all lined up military style. They released 25,000 pigeons, they said. The sky was clouded with pigeons, and the pigeons circled overhead, and then they shot a cannon, and they scared the poop out of the pigeons, and we had straw hats, flat straw hats. You could hear the pitter-patter on our hats. But we felt sorry for the women because they got it in their hair. But I mean, it was a massive dropping, and I tell you, it was so funny.
Once we were all in place, then the torchbearer ran in through the tunnel to go around the stadium.
This was the first time it had ever been done. The Nazis invented the concept of the torch run from ancient Olympia to the host city. This young man ran up the steps all the way up to the top of the stadium, there to light a cauldron, which would start this eternal flame that would burn for the duration of the games.
The 100-meter race, the highlight of the modern Olympic Games, was Jesse Owens's best event. But the stakes were high. A slow start or a faulty step would mean the difference between losing and being crowned the world's fastest man.
You've got, you know, people like Joseph Goebbels, the Nazi propaganda minister, looking at Jesse Owens, and he says, you know, quite openly, I think it's unfair to have people like Jesse Owens competing because you might as well have deer or gazelle on your team.
So notice that's a statement that dehumanizes the person. It treats them like an animal.
Das, ich nenne es mal Stadionklima, hat etwas ganz Besonderes an sich. Es ist vor dem Start die Erwartung, die Stille. Man hört praktisch nichts mehr als nur die Stimme des Starters.
That guy's not gonna do any running, I'm sure.
Owens's main competitors were the German runner Erich Borchmeier and his teammate Ralph Metcalf.
Sie liegen in einer Linie. Jetzt der Start. Auf die Plätze. Fertig. Holländer liegt vorn. Jetzt kommt schon diese Owens auf. Zurück wie Metcalf. Borchmeier kämpft das Feier. Die beiden Vorsprung steht oben, dem Ziel war zu. Er ist oben. Zweiter Metcalf.
Jesse Owens wins in 10.3 seconds, equaling the world record. And now he can breathe.
I'm very glad to have won the 100 meters in the Olympic Games here in Berlin. A very beautiful place and a very beautiful setting. The competition was grand, and we're very glad to come out on top. Thank you, very kindly.
That's called grace in victory.
Tradition called for the leader of the host country to congratulate the gold medal winner. But Hitler refused to greet Owens.
That's called not having grace.
Do you really think, the German leader said, I will allow myself to be photographed shaking hands with a Negro?
So,
the snow.
A lot of people stop the story right there. And it's not a bad place to stop the story, and we won't stop the story there, but it's not a bad place because, in a way, Jesse Owens symbolically defeats Hitler before one soldier dies. What do I mean by that, Megan? What do I mean by Jesse Owens symbolically beats Hitler before even one bullet is fired?
He wanted to prove something.
And what does Jesse Owens prove by winning that race?
That he doesn't deserve to be dehumanized and that he's worth, like, his, he proved that he belongs in the Olympics.
Yeah, more or less. And what, of course, the idea that racial superiority, that Hitler believed that his German people would dominate, and sure enough, he was wrong. So just the symbolism of Hitler being crushed, his team, his sports champions being crushed by Jesse Owens, almost proved before the war started that Hitler had delusions about superiority, and it's a very symbolic victory before the final victory of World War II. Let's keep watching.
Of Jesse Owens' by Adolf Hitler gave the press a hook to really excoriate Adolf Hitler. And to
excoriate's a great word. Excoriate means to sort of bitterly condemn.
Push Jesse Owens to the fore as a man who essentially stuck a thumb in the eye of the Nazi leader and his theories of Aryan superiority.
You follow that, Megan? That's kind of what I said, but he said it much better.
Yes.
That's the idea. And if you guys play sports, this is really should be an interesting moment for you guys to reflect on how sports really is a sort of opportunity to prove your worth without all the other superficial things that we care about on Instagram and Facebook all day long. Oh, this person, this. In sports, it doesn't matter what you look like. It matters how well you play with your team and how well you're able to work with others and how well you do your job. It doesn't matter what race you are. It shouldn't matter what color team, what color or how rich you are. It's all about sort of eliminating all those other things and focusing on the merits of your abilities to play the sport.
As an African American, all of us shared the snubbery by Hitler of Jesse Owens. Jesse was ours, he was us, he was me. And when Hitler snubbed him, he snubbed every one of us.
Dramatic music. So remember, a lot of you guys, if you know the story of Jesse Owens, it usually stops there and we don't hear this part here, but I personally think this part makes the story even more interesting, especially the last part. So we're gonna watch this whole video because it's worth watching the whole thing. Don't worry, I'll make comments throughout.
Germany's top competitor in the broad jump was Lutz Long, the European record holder in the event.
Lutz Long is a German athlete out of Central Casting. He's tall, he's blonde, he's good looking. The rivalry that was going to take place between Lutz Long and Jesse Owens was very much built up by a Nazi regime hungry to show that, in fact, the white man was better.
As the preliminaries got underway, Owens was uncharacteristically sloppy.
Jesse Owens fouled his first attempts in the preliminaries. It was just a run through, and they counted it. And then he fouled the second one, and so he had to qualify in the third one.
Owens was close to being eliminated when Lutz Long offered some friendly advice.
Why don't you just, in your mind, put a mark a foot behind the board, and then you will be certain not to foul. Jesse Owens jumps 25 feet, easily qualifying for the next round. Now we're in the final round of the broad jump, and they put on a spectacular show.
Und so wechselte immer wieder diese Führung. Wenn der eine eine Weite vorlegte, hielt der andere dagegen. Und es war lange nicht klar, wie dieser Wettkampf ausgehen würde.
I have no idea why they don't translate that.
Finally, Jesse Owens jumps 26 feet. Long can't match him at this point. And the gold medal is Owens's.
Long went over to Jesse Owens, he hugged him, and then together they walked arm in arm around the stadium. Now, this was really verboten.
That was extraordinary when you think about it. There are these moments in history when the actors understand that moment in history, and they just do the right thing. Lutz Long did the right thing. That was a very humanizing moment for Owens and for Germany.
So what does he mean by that? That's, I think, one of the more important parts of the video we've seen so far. Evan, you there, buddy?
Yeah.
Did you hear that part?
Yeah.
So what do you think he means by that? What does he mean by like a humanizing moment?
Like, I guess it was Germany was trying to show how powerful like the white race is by that jumper befriending Jesse Owens. It like, I guess shows how they're not really what they say they are.
Yeah, and that's right. I don't know if you heard the first part where Hitler refused to shake hands with Jesse Owens when Jesse Owens won the first event, which was 50 meters, I believe, 100 meters, one or the other.
Yeah.
So and my interpretation of this, and you guys are up to just to decide on your own, but this is what I will offer is my interpretation. I think the German people saw, you know, most people are good people, all right? I think most people are good people. And they were watching the event, and they were wanting to support the guy who wins, the person who wins, the woman who wins. And they saw that Hitler snubbed Jesse Owens. And then the next day, this long jumper is happy to parade around the stadium, a victory lap with Jesse Owens, honoring Jesse Owens for winning. And I think that was his way of saying, oh no, not all the German people are that disgraceful in victory or in loss. Look, let me be a graceful host and march arm in arm with Jesse Owens to show that sports transcends those petty political differences. And I think it's a really solid thing that this guy did to really show what I think most athletes understand, which is, at the end of the game, you shake hands with the other side. And if you don't, you're petty, right? You follow that, Evan?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's really a sad that we don't hear this part of the story because I think it's a really interesting part of the story. But it's not over yet. There's another twist to it coming up, so keep watching.
By the time the runners set their marks for the 200-meter race, thousands of German fans knew they were witnessing something extraordinary.
He hears this shouting, Jesse Owens, Jesse Owens, and he doesn't realize it's him. It's you know, it's obviously the German pronunciation of his name. And he's absolutely lionized by the German people.
So Jesse has won over all the German people. That's awesome. So he's won them over.
Owens won his third gold medal.
You can hear them. They're yelling, Owens.
Owens won his third gold medal, shattering the Olympic 200-meter record. He'd already equaled both the Olympic and world records in the 100 meters, and his record in the long jump would last for decades.
All right, I'm going to pause there so that we can switch video. I'm running out of time here. So check your email in 1 second. I'll send you the link so we can pick up where we left off here in the video.